So we have been discussing about this differential amplifier for the last two lectures. Now here I have drawn the basic differential pair circuit involving two MOS devices, M1 and M2, as you know. And you know, to ensure that the output voltage, that is Vout1 and Vout2, so that it doesn't depend upon the corresponding fluctuation in the input common mode level. So to ensure that particular thing, this current source has been added over here. And as you understand, this current source can also be realized by means of another MOS device operating in the saturation region. Now, so far we have discussed some ideal condition. That means the current source is ideal, which provides infinite output impedance. And we have also assumed that these two parts of the circuit, this left part and the right part, they are also symmetrical in nature. That means if I consider these two MOS, so they are identical as far as their threshold voltage is concerned, as far as their mutual conductance is concerned. And these two resistance values, they are also same, this RD1 and RD2. Although I've written like RD1 and RD2, but so far we have assumed that this might be same. And under this condition, if I apply an input common mode level to each of these two devices, M1 and M2, at the gate of each of these two devices, then you know that whatever be the corresponding output voltage over here, this output voltage is given by this VDD minus ID1 times RD1. And if I assume that these two stages or these two halves, they carry equal amount of current, then it will be nothing but ISS upon 2. So ultimately, this Vout1 and Vout2 will be equal to VDD minus RD into ISS upon 2, if I consider that these two resistances are also same. And you also seen the large signal behavior, that when VIN1 and VIN2, they are same, that means we are applying the same signal. So that signal is known as VINCM, the input common mode level. So whenever we are applying the same signal to each of the gates, then the Vout1 and Vout2 will be same. And if I consider the overall output voltage, that is Vout1 minus Vout2, that will be zero, when VIN1 minus VIN2 is equal to zero. Now today, I'll be invoking some non-ideal condition in this particular discussion. Now to start with, there could have been, first of all, you have to identify the different non-ideal conditions. First of all, let me just take a look at this current source. So far we have assumed that this current source is having infinite output impedance. So in the small signal analysis, we have just ignored the corresponding output impedance. But practically speaking, we can have an output impedance that could have been very large, but that cannot be called to infinity. So we cannot just neglect this current source or the impact of the current source. Secondly, there could have been some problem as far as the manufacturing of these two resistances are concerned. For example, as you know, for integrated circuit, these resistances are also implemented by means of MOS devices. So it is very difficult to assume that these two resistances are same. That means same RD1 and same RD2. There could have been some fluctuation in the value of this RD1 and RD2. And moreover, these two MOSes may not be equal to each other. That means if I consider the threshold voltage of these two MOSes, M1 and M2, and if I consider the corresponding mutual conductance, GM, transconductance, that might not be same. So these are the different non-ideal condition. And today I'll be discussing about these different non-ideal conditions and the impact on the performance of the circuit. Now to start with, initially let me assume that. So first of all, let me just write down the source of non-ideal behavior. The first one is the infinite output impedance of, so these are the ideal condition, infinite output impedance of the current source, of tailing current source. So this is ideal condition, and second one is the symmetricity. Among the two parts of the circuit or two halves of the circuit. So that cannot be true always. I mean, this current source might not be an ideal one, so that you can have some very high value of output impedance over here. And moreover, these two halves may not be symmetric as well. Now, to understand the effect or impact of each of these effects, non-ideal effects, so let me start with the first one. That means, let me consider that the output impedance is finite, large but finite, but these two halves are symmetric in nature. So under this condition, let me once again draw the circuit. I think it will be better if I go to the next slide, because there are certain calculations which need to be performed. So very quickly, let me just draw the previous circuit once again. Now, in this particular diagram, I'm assuming that these two halves are identical to each other. I mean, the left half and the right half, they're identical to each other. But the current source is not an ideal one. So we can have some resistance, although pretty large, but might not be equal to infinity. So let me call this resistance like RSS. And this one is RD, this is also RD. So this is a supply VDD. Now, each of these two MOSes, M1 and M2, they are supplied with same common mode level, I mean, being same, because we are now observing the common mode response of this differential pair or differential amplifier under some non-ideal condition. Now, this is VNCM, the input common mode level that you are applying over here. And accordingly, the outputs will be obtained from these two terminals. So, VOUT1 and VOUT2. So, if I consider this point is X and this point is Y, so the output is nothing but VX minus VY. Now, if you just minutely look at this particular circuit, you'll see that these two MOS, M1 and M2, they are sharing the common gate terminal, because their gates are tied together and supplied with an input common mode level VNCM. Their sources are tied together. And what about the drain potential? As you understand, since the gate potential and the source potential, since the gate to source overdrive and the threshold voltage for these two MOSes being the same, so therefore, under this condition, each of these two MOSes will carry equal amount of current. So the drain current will be same, because we are assuming that these two MOS devices are identical in nature. Moreover, since these two resistances, RD and 1 and RD2, they are also identical, and we are marking this resistance like RD. So therefore, if I just consider the VX and VY, the potential at the node X and the potential in the node Y, they will also be identical in nature. So therefore, we can think that for these two MOS, M1 and M2, the gates are tied together, sources are tied together, and the drain potentials are also tied together. So we can visualize that these two MOSes are basically acting in shunt, or they are appearing in shunt. Now, under this condition, we can simply join these two lines, because the potential at X and potential at Y will be the same as far as these two resistances are same, and as far as the characteristics of these two MOS devices being the same. And we are providing the same gate voltage at each of these two MOS. So let me just connect, because these two potentials being the same. So now what we can do is we can redraw the same circuit. Now see that once again, we can redraw this circuit or simplify the same circuit. So we do have one resistance whose value is nothing but RD upon 2. And this is a combined MOS whose gate, drain, and source terminals are connected to the connected together. That means the gates of M1 and M2 are connected together, drains of M1 and M2 are connected together, and sources are connected together. So they are appearing in shunt path. We are applying the input signal over here. And we do have this resistance, RSS. This one is RD upon 2, and the supply voltage is VDD, and we are applying the input common mode voltage at the gate of this combined MOS. So let me call this as M1 plus M2, and the output is obtained from this terminal, that is Vout. Now, first of all, you have to identify what is the impact of output voltage whenever you are going to change the input voltage, input common mode level. Now, as you go on increasing the value of this input common mode level, so obviously in the first lecture, perhaps we have talked about the corresponding range or allowable range for the input common mode level. Now, within this range, suppose we are just changing intentionally or unintentionally, we're just changing the input common mode level. And let us see what happens for this output voltage. Now, this is the gate potential over here. Now, as you increase the gate potential, so automatically the overdrive voltage for this combined MOS will be higher. And as a matter of fact, it will draw more amount of current. So the drain current that is flowing through this combined MOS will be large, and accordingly, the output potential, if I consider this output potential V out, it will be reduced. So V in CM is obviously certain impact on the V out or V out CM, the common mode level of the output voltage. Now to understand or to now to find out the impact of the change of output common mode level, because of the change of the input common mode level, you need to find out the voltage gain under this common mode scenario. Now, since it is operating in the common source configuration, if I just consider this combined MOS M1 plus M2, since it is operating in common source configuration, so we know that and common source configuration with source degeneration. So that is important. So we have this RSS. So automatically the voltage gain under this condition is nothing but the ratio of two resistances. One is the resistance looking at the drain, and second one is the resistance looking at the source. So resistance looking at the drain is nothing but RD upon 2, and the resistance looking at the source is nothing but, as you know, 1 upon the mutual conductance of this combined MOS plus RSS. Now, what about the mutual conductance of the combined MOS? Now, you know that the mutual conductance or transconductance of any MOS device can be written as, it can be written like twice mu n C aux W upon L into ID. So that is one way of representing the mutual conductance. Now, if I consider that each of these two individual MOSes, they are having a mutual conductance value equal to GM, or let me consider GM1 and GM2 and they are same. So let me assume that each of these two MOSes are having a mutual conductance value of GM1 is equal to GM2, that is equal to GM, because we are assuming that these two MOS are identical in nature. Now, what about the mutual conductance of this combined MOS? Now, for the combined MOS, everything being the same, mu n and C aux, it will be same. The length of the device, I mean, the length of the channel is also same, but they are in shunt path. So let me just very briefly show you the structure. So this is the drain terminal, I mean the channel. If I just consider 3D structure, it will look something like that. So this is for one MOS. So let me call this is the drain one, and this is the source one. And since drain one is connected to drain two and source one is connected to source two, so they are sharing the same potential, just like this. So this is for MOS one, for example, and this is for MOS two. So their drains are tied together and their sources are tied together. So automatically, if I just consider the width of the combined MOS, the width of the combined MOS is twice as compared to the width of the individual MOS. However, the length becoming the same. Same length, but the width has been increased. And what about the current, the drain current, if I consider ID? Automatically, previously, both of them will carry ISS by 2 amount of current. Now, since we are considering the combined MOS will carry the double current. So ID has been increased by 2 times. and W, the width has also been increased by 2 times. So therefore, if I consider for a combined MOS, the corresponding value of GM, so if I write like GM for M1 plus M2, so that is given by twice GM, because W and ID, both of them are increased by a factor of 2. So the combined GM will be twice GM. Then we can I think over here we can write down the expression for the common mode gain, APCM, that is nothing but the ratio between V out upon V in CM. And as you know, this can be written like minus RD by 2 divided by 1 plus 2 GM plus RSS. And ultimately, this can be reduced to minus GM times RD divided by 1 plus 2 GM RSS. Then what is the implication of this common mode gain? What does it imply? The implication is that whenever there is a change in the input common mode level, so that change can be intentional or unintentional. So might be this change is because of some noise. So we always expect that for normal operation of any differential amplifier, we always expect that if V in one looks like this, if this is the waveform for V in one, then the wave shape for V in two will be something like that, where each of them are sharing the same common mode level. I mean, this value, this DC level being the same for each of these two inputs, V in one and V in two. Now, so far we are assuming that this particular level, this V in CM is remaining constant. That means there is no fluctuation of this V in CM. But because of noise, there is a possibility that this V in CM value might get modified. That means instead of having a constant V in CM like this, you can have, so this is the ideal condition for V in CM. You can have a fluctuation like this for the V in CM. Now under this condition, what will be the corresponding change over here? Because if V in CM gets modified, automatically it will change the corresponding bias point of the overall circuit. I mean, the GM value will get modified and the small signal gain will be affected. And ultimately, since V out CM, I mean the output common mode level gets affected because of the change in the input common mode level, so the available swing for the output voltage is also limited because of this change in the V in CM value. So we had to be very much keen about knowing the corresponding fluctuation over here, and that is known by AVCM or the voltage gain under the common mode condition. So what about the corresponding fluctuation on the output CM level, output common mode level, because of the corresponding change in the input common mode level? Now this entire discussion has been carried out with the assumption that the current source is non-ideal in nature. So that's why we have placed one resistance, a very large value in the order of say a few hundreds of mega ohms, but it is not equal to infinite. Now with this assumption, this entire calculation has been done. Now so far we have neglected the second point, that means the symmetricity among the two parts of the circuit. So far we have assumed that each of these two halves, this left half and the right half, they are symmetric in nature. Now what do you mean by the symmetricity? That means, so symmetricity means RD1 is equal to RD2. That is the first assumption. And the second one is this M1 and M2, they are identical in nature. But these two halves, this left half and the right half, may not be symmetric in nature. And accordingly, there could have been two possibilities. First possibility is that these two MOS devices, M1 and M2, they can be identical in nature. That means they are sharing the same value of mutual conductance and the same value of the threshold voltage. However, RD1 and RD2, they are not same. And secondly, we can think that RD1 and RD2, they might be same, but the corresponding MOS devices, M1 and M2, they are not at all identical. That means their GM values are different. So let me start my discussion with the assumption that this RD1 and RD2, they are not the same. And then what is the corresponding impact on the overall output voltage? Let me just add the second, the first possibility. So here I'll be assuming that these two MOS devices are having same value of mutual conductance, that is GM. However, these load resistances RD, they are not the same. And we have this non-ideal current source in place. And gates are tied together. We are observing the common mode response under this non-ideal scenario. So this one is M1, this one is M2. This input is Vin CM. Now, let us assume that this resistance is RD, and this resistance is given by some RD plus some delta RD. Or you can also call like RD1 and RD2. And we have supply VDD. And the outputs are obtained from this point. So let me call this point as X, this point as Y. So Vx and Vy. And the overall output will be nothing but Vx minus Vy. Now, what happens when this input common mode level changes, increases? Now, if VNCM increases, then automatically the overdrive voltage for each of these two MOS devices will increase by same amount because they are sharing the same source terminal and their threshold voltage are also same. So, as a matter of fact, both ID1 and ID2 will be increased. Now, to understand the rate at which this ID1 and ID2 increases. So for this reason, you have to draw the small signal equivalent circuit, or just by inspection also, you can understand. I think it will be better if I just draw the small signal equivalent circuit. So over here, let me just very quickly show you. So this one is V in CM, and between gate to source, suppose we have V1. This one is GM. Let me start with the leftmost only, that is M1. So let this be GM1 V1. And this one is RSS. So as you understand, the drain current ID1 is nothing but GM1 times V1. Then what is the relation between this V1 and VNCM? Now GM1 V1 is the drain current, so that kind will flow through this RSS. So we can write VNCM. If I apply KVL over here, that is nothing but V1 plus GM1 times V1. Times RSS. So V1 into 1 plus GM1 times RSS. So ID1 is equal to GM1 upon 1 plus GM1 times RSS into VNCM. So that can also be obtained just by inspection. Anyway, so we have ID1 is equal to GM1 upon 1 plus GM1 RSS into VNCM. So automatically, if there is certain change in the VNCM value, and rather if VNCM increases by some amount, automatically ID1 will increase by a factor of GM1 upon 1 plus GM1 RSS time delta VNCM. And same is the case for ID2. The only change will be in GM. So instead of having GM1, you can have GM2, But so far we are assuming that these two MOS devices being identical in nature, so we can say that the corresponding increase in the drain current will be identical, because we are assuming that GM1 and GM2 being the same. So therefore, we can think that the corresponding change or corresponding enhancement in ID, that is delta ID1 and delta ID2, the corresponding change in the drain current being the same, and that is nothing but GM times 1 plus GMRS multiplied with delta VNCM. That is fine. But even if the drain current changes by equal amount because of the corresponding change in the input common mode level, but the output voltage will not be affected equivalently. What I mean to say is that the output Vx and Vy, the corresponding output terminals, are obtained like VDD minus ID1 RD and VDD minus ID2 RD. Now here ID1 and ID2, the corresponding increase in ID1 and ID2 being the same, but the resistance values are not the same. In one case you have RD, and in other case you have RD plus delta RD. And if VNCM increases, so let me just go to this slide. If delta VNCM is positive, I mean if VNCM increases, if it is positive, then it implies delta ID1 and delta ID2, delta ID1 and delta ID2, they will also increase. And this implies delta Vx and delta Vy, they will reduce, because Vx can be represented like VDD minus ID1 times RD, and Vy can be represented by VDD minus ID2 times, now you have RD plus delta RD. But remember, the corresponding change in delta Vx and delta Vy will not be the same. So we can simply write the expression for delta Vx. So delta Vx, we can write this as, already we have seen the corresponding change in delta ID. So this is nothing but minus delta ID1 times RD, and that is equal to minus GMRD upon 1 plus GMRSS times delta VNCM. And however, for Vy, this is minus delta ID2 times RD plus delta RD. Sorry, delta RD. RD plus delta RD. So this can be written like minus GM times RD plus delta RD divided by 1 plus GM RSS times delta V in CM. So now if you closely observe these two expressions, remember that we are applying input common mode level. We are applying V in CM. So far we never applied the differential input. So in case of differential input only, you expect that the corresponding outputs will be different. But here we are applying the same input, same V in CM to each of these two MOS, and assuming that these two MOS, they are identical in nature. However, the only change occurs, or only mismatch occurs, in the value of the resistance. And under this condition, even if we apply some input common mode level, it results in some differential component at the output terminal. Because now if you compute delta Vx and delta Vy, and if you just find out the corresponding difference, this delta Vx minus delta Vy, so this will not be equal to zero, because of the fact that this RD1 and RD2, they are not the same. For delta Vx, the corresponding change is represented by this one, So everything being the same, this GM, RSS, delta V and same, so everything being the same, you have only RT in the numerator for delta Vx, and for delta Vy, you have RT plus delta RT. So although you are applying the input on mode level, I mean V and CM, the constant same voltage to each of the gates of these two MOS devices. But if I just consider the output terminal, the corresponding change in the output terminal, you'll see that there is a differential component, and which is an undesired one, because we have never applied any differential input. We have applied common mode input, but we are getting some differential change in the output. So this is obviously undesirable. Now that has been obtained with RT1 not equal to RT2. Now the second mismatch, a second source of mismatch, can happen because of the fact that these two MOS devices, M1 and M2, they are not identical. What I mean by that? That means they are having different values for the mutual conductance. Now for this particular case, for the sake of simplicity, now while assuming that these two MOS devices are not, I mean they are not same, they are not identical to each other, so let me assume that now this RD1 and RD2 being the same, and let us check what about the corresponding impact of having different GMs for each of these two MOS devices. So we are once again disturbing the symmetricity among the two halves of the circuit, the left half and the right half. The first part we have already discussed, that RD1 is not equal to RD2. Now while considering the second part, that M1 is not equal to M2, that means they are not identical to each other, we are assuming that this first criteria is satisfied. That means they are having the same value of the resistance. So for this, the circuit will be like this one. Now we are assuming that these two MOS, M1 and M2, they are having different values for mutual conductance. And let us check what about the corresponding impact. So same RT we are considering. This one is M1, this one is M2, and we are applying same input common mode level. Let me call these two points as X and Y. So the corresponding outputs will be nothing but Vx minus Vy. Now we can easily find that if ID1 being the current through the MOS M1, then ID1 can be represented by the lower drive voltage minus overdrive voltage multiplied with this mutual conductance. So overdrive voltage can be represented like V in CM minus this potential. So if I consider this point to be point S, corresponding to the source of these two MOS, and if I just neglect the threshold voltage at this moment, if I assume that the gate to source overdrive is much, much larger as compared to the threshold voltage, then ID1 can be represented like this GM1 times V in CM minus the source potential Vs. And similarly, ID2 can be represented by GM2 times V in CM minus Vs. So the overdrive voltage being the same, but because of the change in GM1 and GM2, the ID1 and ID2 will be different. So there is a difference from the last discussion. Last time we have seen that the gate to source overdrive being the same and mutual conductance is also the same. So that's why the corresponding change in ID1 and ID2 was the same, but the corresponding change in the output voltage was different because of the change in the resistance value. But this time, the resistance being the same, but the corresponding change in the current, drain current ID1 and ID2 are different. Now, the total current that is flowing through this is nothing but the summation of this ID1 and ID2, and this current, when multiplied with RSS, will give you the source potential. Now, from this, we can find out the relationship between VNCM and VS. So, what we can find is GM1 times VNCM minus VS plus GM2 times VNCM minus VS whole multiplied with RSS. Is equal to VS. So what you can see, V in CM into GM1 plus GM2 times RSS, that is equal to VS plus, we have GM1 plus GM2 times RSS into VS. That means if I take VS common, then 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. So it relates V in CM with VS. Then we have to identify the expression for VX and VY. So as you know, VX can be represented like VDD minus ID1 times RD. And VY can be represented like VDD minus ID2 times RD. So then the corresponding change, I mean VX minus VY can be written like, so VX minus VY, if I just compute the differential output, so that differential output is equal to let me once again write it down over here. VX equal to VDD minus ID1 times RD, and VY is equal to VDD minus ID2 times RD. So VX minus VY is equal to minus ID1 minus ID2 times RD. And let me once again write down the expression for ID1. So it is nothing but GM1 times VNCM minus VS. And similarly for ID2, it is nothing but GM2 times VNCM minus VS. So therefore, this VX minus VY can be written like GM1 minus GM2 times V in CM minus VS times RD. only do we have calculated the relationship between V in CM and Vs. So that is given by V in CM is equal to Vs into. So let me once again write it down. V in CM into GM1 plus GM2 times RSS into GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. That was equal to Vs into 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. So that was the expression which we have already derived. So we have to represent the entire thing in terms of V in CM only. So we have to substitute the value for Vs over here. We find that Vs is equal to GM1 plus GM2 divided by 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. Now you have RSS over here times V in CM. So putting this value over here, what we find, you have GM1 minus GM2, and let me put the value for Vs. So V in CM is there, minus you have GM1 plus GM2 times RSS divided by 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS into V in CM. Now if you just simplify this one, so now in the numerator you have 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 RSS minus this, so that part get cancelled, and ultimately this will be this can be simplified to minus, and obviously I have missed this RD part. So now you have GM1 minus GM2 into RD, and then you have V in CM. And in the denominator, you have 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. Now to segregate, I think I should a different line. So that's a separate calculation. Anyway, so what we find here is Vx minus Vy. Even if I apply the common mode value V in CM, we find that this Vx minus Vy, the differential output is dependent upon the corresponding change in V in CM. So if delta V in CM is not equal to zero, so this is the expression for Vx minus Vy, then what about delta Vx minus delta Vy? So if there is certain change in V in CM, then this corresponding fluctuation, corresponding variation in the differential output can be written like minus this entire thing multiplied with delta V in CM. Now, as long as delta V in CM is zero, there is no problem. But if delta V in CM is non-zero, then obviously this problem will be very much pertinent. And we can ultimately simplify this expression to be like minus delta GM times RD divided by 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. multiplied with VXM. Now to explain the implication of this variation of VXM, let me just consider a differential pair and so let us consider this differential amplifier consisting of two MOS devices. Now we are invoking all the non-ideal condition in this particular circuit. So let us call this is RD. This is to be RD plus delta RD. That means these two load resistance not being the same. This one is M1, this one is M2, and they are not the same. And we are applying a signal like this. For M1, we will be applying a waveform like this, V in 1, if I consider, which is riding on VNCM. And at the gate of M2, we will be applying a waveform like this. If I just consider the differential, so it will be something like that. So it is also riding. So this is for V in 1 and this is for V in 2. So both V in 1 and V in 2, they are riding on the same V in CM value, and the corresponding fluctuations are just opposite and equal. Now that can be simply shown by virtue of two different voltage sources. I mean, this V in 1 and V in 2 can be decomposed. Each of them can be decomposed as the common mode component plus the differential component. So let me just show you the each of these two components. So let us call this is the differential component without any DC value. So this is the differential component. If I consider V in differential input or differential mode, and with this the common mode signal is added. So the common mode signal is the DC signal that is V in CM. So this V in 1 and V in 2 can be decomposed into two different signal. For V in 1 we have V in CM plus some V1 like this, and for V in 2 we have same V in CM and minus of that V1. Now if, and obviously let me just show you the output terminal. So these are the two terminals, and we'll be taking the output across these two. So let this point be Vx, this point is Y. So we'll be taking the output between these two, that means Vx minus Vy. Now if everything is fine, if the input common mode level looks something like that, and the differential input looks like this, then obviously we'll be having an amplified output. We'll be having an amplified output like this. Let me phase shift, because we're applying this to the input of, to the gate of M1, and obviously the negative part will be applied over here. So automatically this will be the differential output in absence of any disturbance in the common mode level. Now suppose there is a corresponding disturbance in the common mode level. Suppose the V in CM is not constant, it's not fixed. Rather, it is like it's having a noisy variation like this. Over the Wien CM value, there is a noisy fluctuation like this. Now, because of that particular thing, and if these non-idealities are taken into consideration, then obviously the overall output, I mean Vx minus Vy, will also have the corresponding common mode disturbance in its output waveform. So that is one of the primary objectives in forming the differential amplifier, that we are interested to eliminate the common mode disturbance, the common mode noise. The environmental noise has to be reduced by virtue of the differential amplifier. But if these non-ideal conditions are taken into consideration, then obviously we find that these fluctuations are taking place. And obviously we must appreciate that these fluctuations are not at all desirable. We want that the differential component must be amplified. I mean, the difference between this waveform and this waveform, that should be amplified by this particular enhancement, not this noisy part. But already I've seen that because of the change in VNCM, if there is certain change in VNCM, then obviously this delta Vx minus delta Vy, so that part is also getting affected, and which gives rise to the common mode to differential mode conversion, because we have provided some common mode input, but at the output we find that there is a certain component or certain differential component present at the output, and this is defined, or this is parameterized by means of one metric, and that metric is known as the gain for common mode to differential mode conversion. Now already we have seen that this Vx minus Vy, in the last slide we have seen Vx minus Vy written like minus delta Gm, but delta Gm was nothing but Gm1 minus Gm2, as you understand. So let me write down over here, delta Gm was nothing but Gm1 minus Gm2. So delta Gm times Rd upon 1 plus Gm1 plus Gm2 times RSS into VNCM. So from that we can easily find out the expression for the common mode to differential mode conversion. I mean, what about the gain for this common mode to differential mode conversion? And obviously that part is undesirable. We don't want these values should be to be high enough, and that is nothing but the ratio between these two, and which is nothing but, if I just consider the magnitude of this, that is nothing but delta Gm times Rd upon 1 plus Gm1 plus Gm2 times RSS. Now, as you can see, if there is no change between the two mutual conductance, I mean Gm1 and Gm2, both of them are same, obviously this ACM slash DM, that is common mode to differential mode gain, obviously that part will be zero if delta Gm is equal to zero. Moreover, if RSS is equal to infinite, I mean if this current source is having infinite impedance, infinite output resistance, then also that gain should also be zero. But unfortunately, if I consider some finite value for RSS and some non-zero value for this delta Gm, that means Gm1 is not equal to Gm2, then obviously this corresponding gain, and which is undesired one, is not equal to zero. Now we have to always find out the implication of this by virtue of another parameter, which is known as the purely differential gain. Whenever we apply a purely differential signal, that means V1 in one of the input of the MOS and the minus of V1 to the other input, just like this. So whenever we apply this signal to one of the input of the MOS and this input minus of this to the other input, then the output, what we'll be getting over here, is the truly differential output which we want to maximize, which we want to amplify, and that gain is known as the truly differential gain, or the gain pertaining to the differential mode operation, a truly differential mode operation. And that should be high enough. That is our objective. We have to maximize the gain corresponding to this difference voltage. And however, we always want that this particular component should be minimized. So there is one parameter which has been specified, which can identify whether the corresponding differential amplifier is performing well in regard to the exclusion of the common mode noise, or how far it can reject the common mode noise. And that particular parameter is known as common mode rejection ratio, or in short, CMRR, common mode rejection ratio, which gives a measure about how far your circuit is able to suppress the common mode noise. And that is defined by the ratio of the purely differential mode gain divided upon this common mode to differential mode fluctuation. So ideally, it should be infinite CMRR, common mode rejection ratio. That should be infinite ideally, but practically, we should expect that that value should be as high as possible. That means the value of ADM should be as large as possible, and at the same time, the value of ACM/DM should be as low as possible. Now let us try to find out the value for this ADM, that is the truly differential gain. Assuming that these non-ideal conditions are present. So already we have calculated or we have done this calculation in the last day with certain assumption. Now in this particular lecture, I will be invoking those non-ideal conditions into our considerations, and accordingly we will be finding out expression for ADM. So let me just draw the circuit first. I mean the same circuit I am drawing once again. Now, whenever we will be considering the truly differential gain, then one input is Vin1, the other input is Vin2, and for a truly differential gain, or for the computation of truly differential gain, this Vin1 must be equal to minus Vin2. So there are two inputs. Let me just show you the corresponding fluctuation. Suppose Vin1 looks like this and Vin2 looks like this. Now we have already calculated the expression for the gain last day, but that time we do not have any explicit RSS. In fact, we do have an ideal current source, and that can be just approximated to be having infinite impedance. But the process being the same, so since there are two inputs, V1 and V2, and we have to find out this Vx minus Vy as the differential output. So considering the superposition theorem, we have to apply the input one after another. So first, let us assume that we are applying the input Vin1, and we do the entire calculation assuming the Vin1 is present, and from that we can easily find out what will be the corresponding differential output when Vin2 is present. Now when Vin1 is present only, then if I want to find out the value for Vx, then it will be something like that. So in fact, that we have already discussed in the last class. we have a situation like this, and this is the gate terminal. Gate terminal is grounded over here. This is VIN 1, RD, VDD. So VX, this one is M1, this one is M2. I'm not just drawing the, okay, let me just complete the circuit itself. This VDD. Now last we have seen that this MOS to second MOS is acting as a resistance, source resistance, for this MOS M1. The MOS M1 is the basic amplifier over here, because input is applied at the gate of this MOS. And we have to consider the common source kind of configuration, because the input is applied at the gate and the output is obtained from the drain terminal. So this configuration is nothing but a common source MOS amplifier with source degeneration. And that degenerated resistance is being provided by this second MOS, that is M2. So that we have already done in the last day. The only difference over here is that now between this source terminal, this terminal to ground, there is another resistance. So last time we have just neglected that part, assuming that this is infinite. So this time we cannot do that. And we know for a degenerated common source configuration, this Vx upon VIN1, this can be written like, this is nothing but the ratio of two resistance. One is in the numerator, you have the resistance looking at the drain, that is RT simply. And in the denominator, you have the resistance looking at the source. And what about the resistance? Now you have to consider that the resistance being provided by this MOS M2 is nothing but 1 upon GM2. And last time what we have done, we have considered you have 1 upon GM2 over here. And for this MOS M1, the corresponding resistance is nothing but 1 upon GM1. So 1 upon GM1 plus 1 upon GM2. But this time this 1 upon GM2 is coming in shunt with RSS. So therefore it will be modified, and you have like 1 upon GM1 plus, and if you just calculate this expression, 1 upon GM2 parallel RSS, this will give you like 1 upon GM2 times RSS divided by 1 upon GM2 plus RSS. That means if you just multiply with the GM2, it will give you RSS upon 1 plus GM2 RSS. So that you can place over here RSS upon 1 plus GM2 RSS. Then ultimately, this can be simplified to be, in the numerator, you have GM1 into 1 plus GM2 RSS times RD. And in the denominator, you have 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. So that is the expression for Vx upon VIN1. So last day, we have got the same expression with the assumption that RSS was equal to infinite. Now, let me just consider the calculation of Vy when the input was applied at VIN1. So now this time, we have to consider the MOS2 M2 as the amplifying device. So MOS2 is the amplifying device, and the gate is grounded, AC ground. So it is operated in the common gate configuration. This one is M2. Now, if I just consider at the source end, there is resistance, that is RSS, which was absent last time, source to ground or source to ground. And the effect of the first MOS, that is M1, can be implemented by means of V in 1 and 1 upon GM1. So that part we have already seen in the last time. Now, if I consider the effective resistance, so the effective resistance looking at the source, and obviously we have to take the output from this terminal. This is the VY. So this MOS M2 is acting in the common gate configuration. The input is applied at the source terminal and the output is obtained from the drain terminal. Gate is essentially grounded, DC ground. And accordingly, we have to find out the expression for VY upon VIN or VIN1. In fact, we have started with VIN1 and VIN2, right? Yeah, VIN1 and VIN2. Okay. So now, what about the effective impedance? First of all, you have to calculate the effective impedance looking at the source. So the effective impedance is nothing but 1 upon GM1 parallel combination with RSS. And if I consider that the effective voltage that is available over here, let me call this voltage as VT. Effective voltage over here, if I just simplify the diagram once again like this. We have last day considered this type of circuit. So let me consider this voltage to be VT and this is say RT. I think I can redraw this circuit once again because it seems very small. Anyway, so it will be something like that. So let me call this voltage to be the VT, this one let me call RT. We have VDD over here, RD, and we're taking the output from this terminal, that is VY. Then what about VT? So VT is nothing but V in 1 upon RSS plus 1 upon GM1. Multiplied with RSS. So it will give you GM1 times RSS divided by 1 plus GM1 RSS times VIN1. And RT is nothing but the same expression what you have got last time. And the only change is that instead of GM2, you should have GM1 only. So this is nothing but RSS upon 1 plus GM1 RSS. So now we are in a position in calculating the gain between VY and VT. So VY upon VT, since it's a common gate configuration, so that can be written like RD upon 1 upon GM2 plus this resistance, that is RSS, by 1 plus GM1 RSS. But there is no negative sign because it's a common gate configuration. So we have 1 plus GM1 RSS multiplied with GM2 times RD in the numerator, and in the denominator we should have 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. Now it relates Vy with Vt, but we are interested in calculating Vy upon V in 1. So Vy upon Vt was like 1 plus GM1, hopefully. Let me just check. Yeah, 1 plus GM1 RSS into GM2 RTT. GM1 RSS into GM2 RT. And in the numerator, in the denominator, you have 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. Now Vt was equal to GM1 RSS by 1 plus GM1 RSS into V in. So GM1 RSS divided by 1 plus GM1 RSS into V in 1. So therefore Vy divided by GM1 RSS into V in 1, and in the numerator you should have 1 plus GM1 times RSS, that is equal to 1 plus GM1 RSS GM2 RT divided by 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. So this factor gets cancelled from the left hand side and the right hand side, and ultimately we are left with Vy upon V in 1, that is equal to GM1 GM2 into 1 plus GM1 RSS. Sorry, so that part gets cancelled, so that part will not be there. So we should have GM1 GM2 into RSS into RD and the denominator we have 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. So these are the two expressions for the voltage gain. One was Vx upon V in 1 when we apply the input voltage over here, and we have calculated the corresponding output voltage at this drain terminal of MOS 1. So that ratio we have calculated already, Vx upon V in 1, this one. And the second one was Vx Vy upon V in 1. So because of the application of V in 1, what about the differential voltage we are getting can be directly obtained like Vx minus Vy. So let me once again write down the expression for Vx upon V in 1 and Vy upon V in 1. So that expression is GM1 into 1 plus GM2 RSS. Okay. So Vx upon V in 1 is equal to minus GM1 into 1 plus GM2 RSS times RD divided by 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. And Vy upon V in 1, just now we have calculated, that is GM1, GM2, RSS, RT, okay. So there is no negative sign. GM1, GM2, RSS, RT, and the denominator being the same. So Vx minus Vy upon V in 1 is nothing but we have minus, obviously, Gm1 times Rd, and then Gm1, Gm2, RSS, Rd, and then twice Gm1, Gm2, RSS, Rd, divided by 1 plus Gm1 plus Gm2 times RSS. Now we can readily verify that with the condition that RSS is equal to infinite and Gm1 is equal to Gm2 is equal to Gm, that expression of this voltage gain Vx minus Vy upon V in 1 is reduced to minus Gm times Rt that we have discussed, that we have calculated in the last day. This is the more generic expression involving a practical value for RSS and concerning two different mutual conductance for the two MOS devices. So Vx minus Vy by V in 1 can be represented by this expression. Now for V in 2, as you understand, for V in 2, then obviously there will be no negative sign outside, because whenever we calculate Vx minus Vy upon V in 2, then the input is applied at the gate of the second MOS, and while calculating Vx, we have to identify this corresponding application like a common gate, and while applying, while calculating Vy, we have to consider the corresponding amplifier to be of common source. Then accordingly, this Vx minus Vy, since common gate minus common source, then automatically the difference will give you the positive gain. We have also verified this one in the last day. That means Vx minus Vy upon V in 2, when the V in 2 was applying alone, in that case, that value was equal to Gm times Rt. But this time, it will not be simply Gm times Rt. Rather, you have to make it more general, and we can easily verify it to be Gm2 times Rt plus 2 Gm1 Gm2 RSS Rd upon 1 plus Gm1 plus Gm2 times RSS. That is one thing, Vx minus Vy upon V into. That means when V into is being applied only, then whatever the differential voltage gain, Vx minus Vy upon V into. Now, since we are applying only the differential input, that means V in 1 is equal to minus V in 2. So this V in 2 can be represented like minus V in 1, because we are interested in calculating the differential mode gain, that is ADM, with these non-ideal situations. So instead of writing V in 2, we can simply write minus V in 1. So if I write it like minus V in 1, then Vx minus Vy upon minus V in 1 is equal to this expression, Gm2 times Rd plus twice Gm1 Gm2 RSS Rd upon 1 plus Gm1 plus Gm2 times RSS. Now, if I just omit this negative sign from this point and put it over here, then you will see two different expressions for Vx minus Vy upon V in 1. In one expression, you find that this is the value, Vx minus Vy upon V in 1. And in the second case, you find this to be the value. In fact, since the left-hand side being the same, the right-hand side must also be the same. So therefore, if I call this entire thing, if I call this entire thing, if I call this entire thing equal to say AV, then this is also equal to AV, because both of them are referring to the same quantity. So now we have two different expressions for AV. We have AV is equal to GM1 RD plus, I mean, if I just consider mod AV, in fact, it will be better if I just call mod AV. Or rather, I think we can write like Vx minus Vi upon V0 is equal to minus AV. So simply, we can write 2 GM1 GM2 RSS RD upon 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. And similarly, we can also write AV to V GM2 times RD plus twice GM1 GM2 RSS RD divided by 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. Let me call this equation to be equation number 1 and this to be equation number 2. Now if I add 1 and 2, what we find is twice AV is equal to GM1 plus GM2 times RD plus 4 GM1 GM2 RSS RD. Divided by 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. So the expression for AV can be written like, if I take just RD outside, it's nothing but RD by 2. In the numerator, you have GM1 plus GM2 plus 4 GM1 GM2 RSS, and in the numerator, in the denominator, you have 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. So this is the final expression for the voltage gain, and rather it will be better if I write in terms of ADM. Right, so ultimately what we find is Vx minus Vy is equal to minus AV times V in 1. And you also find Vx minus Vy is equal to AV times V in 2 with V in 2 is equal to minus V in 1, or V in 1 is equal to minus V in 2, because we are applying the differential input. So if I just consider the ADM, the differential gain that is given by Vx minus Vy by V in 1 minus V in 2. So that is equal to the gain which we just now calculated. In fact, we have to consider the mode of that. In fact, we should have a negative sign. So it will be better if I just consider the modulus. So it was like R d by 2. And in the numerator, you have GM1 plus GM2 plus 4 GM1 GM2 R SS. And in the denominator, you have 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times R SS. So this is the more generic expression. Last day, we have just calculated the specific one with GM1 equal to GM2 and RSS equal to infinite. So ultimately, this will give you the expression for ADM, that is the differential gain. And already we have calculated the expression for ACM dash DM. That was like delta GM RT divided by 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 RSS. So from that, we can easily find out the expression for the common mode rejection ratio, or CMRR. So let me just once again write down the expression for ACM slash DM, that is the common mode to differential mode gain, which is the undesirable one. And it was like delta GM times RT divided by 1 plus GM1 plus GM2 times RSS. So from these two, you can simply calculate the common mode rejection ratio, and which we always want to maximize. Let me just write down the final expression. So it was like you have this numerator, I mean in the denominator you have the same component, so it will be cancelled simply, and RD also gets cancelled. So you have in the numerator you have this entire thing GM1 plus GM2 GM1 plus GM2 plus 4 GM1 GM2 RSS, and the denominator you should have twice delta GM. As you understand, if delta GM equal to 0, that means if there is no mismatch between these two MOS devices in terms of their transconductance, then obviously the value for this common mode rejection ratio will be pretty large. Now with this, let me conclude this discussion on differential amplifier.